look, what is it, New Girl and Double Dime. Their numbers have, and I love it. But people were saying, oh, the numbers have dropped. Why are they still in the comic book stores? Because it's in Scholastic. It's in Barnes and Noble.
Mm-hmm.
They don't, mainstream, if you ask a 7-year-old, hey, tell me what you like about the vertical of this comic, they're like, it's a girl on a dinosaur. Getting the demographic of kids that actually write comics. So when I talk to people who are like, oh, how can I really get involved and get my comic out there? If you don't have a comic book for children right now, you will be broke. Because that's what's missing.
Well, that's good. Take a break to everybody. This, the industry is going to die if we don't start catering to young people.
Yep.
Because the audience that the main comic book publishers cater to are all, most of them are about to qualify for AARP. the numbers are dwindling, and that's why the sales are dwindling, because they're still catering to that particular audience. It's, how many kids do you see out there reading comics? When I was a kid, all kids were reading comics, but that was also because comics were affordable. We priced them out, we make them hard. But if you go to Walmart right now, and I'm not saying anyone should go to Walmart because they're a bad company, right? But if you go to Walmart, you can buy underwear, you can buy tampons, you can buy guns, and you can buy milk, but you can't buy comic books at Walmart.
David, did you buy all those things at Walmart recently?
I was looking for sure.
That's a good segue. I mean, it's important to come to the New York Comic Cons and the San Diego Comic Cons and the Dragon Cons. But how many of you guys have been to Ekbok and Phil or Honest Con in Atlanta, which are small independent shows? Like Awesome Con, Blurred Con now in DC. The small shows where you're going to see independent creators. You know, people from all walks of life who have a story to tell and they get their book out. And it's important to support the big ones, but we have to take the time to support the independents as well, because the good stuff's out there. But we don't have the marketing machine, the juggernauts behind us pushing all this stuff. But the quality of the stories is the same. You know, I've been in the independent shows for a decade, and the Marvel guys and the DC guys are always there taking notes. You know, they're always looking for ideas, because the ideas come from the grassroots, always.
And now, content's easier to create. So if you support a comic book well, they have the money to do a video game. They have the money to do a cartoon on their own, because they can produce that stuff at a pretty high level for a little more money. But because they don't have enough money to start the comic book series, they can't even start off the ground, which means no momentum for them. You know, if you support the comic book, they can sell it to a studio. I used to work for Bill Duke. We used to pitch all the time. And one of the great hardships was people who had comic books couldn't print them. They didn't have the money to just get it printed. They had it done. You couldn't pitch it. You couldn't walk in the room and hand it to them.
I just got to say something, though. I read comic books. I don't watch TV. I hardly watch movies. And I'm tired of people talking about, I just want to get a TV show. I just want to make comics. Right? I just want to make comics. It's getting harder to make a living at it, but it's like, we have to support, and this is the problem, right? This is the real problem. Like, I love every one of you in this room. You're the choir. We're up here preaching to you. We need to preach outside of this room, right? We need to convert other people. We're not in the biggest room. We needed a bigger room. There's people that didn't get in, right? But we need to talk to our friends and our family. And we need to, if you like Moon Girl or Devil Dinosaur, or if you like Saga, or whatever you might like, you gotta give those to your friends and get them to buy them and explain to them the backwards notions of pre-orders, as God knows, that's gonna, they don't get, my mom doesn't know how to buy comic books. I explain to her every month. She's like, how come I can't buy new comic books at the store? My, you gotta pre-order. That's it, But that's it, we have to spread the message outside of this room. This is what I'm always saying, because if all we're doing is talking to ourselves, we're patting ourselves on the back, yeah, Black Heroes Matter. But it's like, we've talked about this before, I wear my shirt, and like people get up in my face and be like, yo, what's up with that shirt? Or actually they go, hey, what's up with that shirt? And it's like, my first instinct is to punch somebody in the face, but I realize that's not going to do any good. So I have to break it down and go, hey, look, this is, tell them about watching Superman the movie as a kid and being like, can you imagine what that would have felt like if that was you? You know, and then sometimes you gotta punch you in the face.
We're talking about that, Ryan, right?
Punching people in the face?
I know, about misconceptions that people don't have about Black Heroes Matter, right? I'm somebody who, you know, I love the Black Lives Matter network, local network, and I love everybody within the movement for Black Lives, which is the bigger network that holds so many other Black-centric organizing groups. And I was just telling Ryan that Patrice Cullors has a new book coming out next year with Simon & Schuster called When They Call You a Terrorist, memoir. Right, and I thought, we really need that book, right? We really need folks to actually know that, unfortunately, and the news is coming out, and they just said it this week, that Russia had actually bought ads that were promoting attack ads on Black Lives Matter, right? And that's what we as Black activists and Black advocates, unfortunately, have been experiencing, is people thinking that we're doing bad things, right? When, like, the last thing I did with Black Lives Matter was go to a park in Oakland, pull a bunch of weeds and stuff, and make it into a park for children, and then we reclaimed it, and, like, made a barbecue and handed out a whole bunch of food to all the homeless there, right? And there was not a single person there handing out food to the Black people there, right? The poorest of Oakland were left behind, right? Except for a couple superheroes out there, right? So, and I tell people, you know, there's a lot of people doing work, right? I have my website called Yes Black People. If you're a Black individual interested in finding folks across the country who are interested in serving you, all of the Green Book, come visit our website. And we're really interested in doing something different, not necessarily exclusion, right? That's not what we're about, right? My husband's white. I like white people. They're good. But I think it's important to say. I say to people, because people are like, oh, you must not. I'm like, no. Part of the reason why I'm in this work is because of the fact that I was, you know, raised transracial. Both my parents, Black people, married white folks, right? So that's part of the reason why I talk this way. That's what happened. I was raised in San Luis Obispo, right? I found my way to Blackness, to Black people, to Black love, right? To that positivity. And that's what I see in everybody here on this panel is like this very, like, isn't this exciting, right? So if we get a chance to take that excitement out of this room, right? And every time you see another Black person, brown person, Muslim person, Jewish person, any person that you can identify as different, and you say, I hope you had a good day today, right? That's the spirit, hopefully, of Black Heroes Matter too.
San Diego Comic-Con. I'll tell the story.
This is a good story.
This is a real one.
This is just to lay it out there, so, because I know no matter how much we talk about Black Heroes Matter and no matter what we do or whatever we push out and give to the audience, there are people who are going to take it wrong. It's just going to happen. So, true story. I like that level. I was at San Diego Comic-Con. I was sitting at a table just like this, just selling shirts and stuff. And this one guy wheeled up to me with a good chair, and he was like, "Hey, Black Heroes Matter, you guys a terrorist group?" And I stood there for a minute. I'm like, "What?" And then everyone around me just stopped and looked at him. And then he asked me again. I mean, he gets a terrorist group. I said, bro, this is about, you know, heroes, uplifting people. It's comics. It has nothing to do with anything that's in your head. And his response was, well, as long as you do the Martin Luther King and not the Malcolm X thing.
You got the best laugh.
Of y'all, right? It really was a beautiful moment. She was scared by faith and humanity.
I've studied MMA and Muay Thai for the past 21 years now. This was like way back when you guys were in the old UFC. Back in the day when they would put like the 300-pounder versus, you know, I was...
Wait, were you going to do Muay Thai on a dyno?
I'd rather give him a blue tie verbal
I just want to clarify. That could be a problem.
So, you know, so I just had to just straighten the guy out, and that's basically the story. And just to let you guys know, this is nothing. It's like, you know, there's nothing that's
I agree with what you're saying. I don't think that you would hate this person, but what I'm trying to say is that for some reason, this is syntax in the media on every topic right now. Whenever somebody says this thing matters, for some reason it's taken as nothing else does.
Right.
And everything else is less than. Yeah. And everything else is crap.
Well, to be fair, it wouldn't be anything that black people said related to their own liberation that would be pushed back on.
That's true, but I'm just saying, when people want to use the syntax, like, well, all lives matter, or, you know, Latino lives matter, Asian lives matter, of course they do. That's not the point. The point is, if somebody says, like, I want you to pay attention to this thing right here, and you're right, most black people, the moment we say, hey, I like orange notebooks, it's like, why don't you like blue?
Well, I was going to ask you this. You were doing the no Confederate, right? Were you engaged with that?
Oh, yeah, no.
And I saw you in, like, I would just try to wake up and be like, they're in time to, like, go after trolls and be like, and no. But it was terrible. Just the fact that you were saying, hey, I think this is not a good idea.
This is a bad idea all the way around. And it's like, well, why? I'm like, because slavery. Now, at the end of the day, if they do the show, which they very might well do it, I will watch it. Do I think it should be done? No, I don't agree with it. But if they do it, I'm not watching HBO, you know what I mean, to support that. At the same time, there's people that get up in the morning and don't go to bed and just want to battle people online. And I will engage. Most people know that's my Twitter. I will engage. But the moment you are not respectful, I just block. I got stuff to do.
Don't block.
That's true.
You can see when you block them.
Yeah.
But mute, they're just screaming into the wind.
Remember though, privilege allows you to be blind, right? And I don't want to be, if I'm blind, I don't want to have to see it. Because if I see it, I have to recognize it and have to deal with it. So I'm going to shut my eyes. So you saying black heroes matter makes me have to think about, why did I not look at that before? So